This is a Heathkit model T4 signal tracer. I've been looking for a signal tracer for quite some time, especially a Heathkit one, obviously because all my other test equipment in my collection is Heathkit. This was the only item that I was actually considering not getting a Heathkit. I was considering an Ico or another brand of test equipment. And the reason is that this Heathkit signal tracer commands such an unbelievably high price on eBay that it wasn't worth it. And when these appear on eBay, they not only do they command such an unbelievably high price, but the second they appear, even when there's, you know, several days of bidding left, I mean, the bidding war start the second it posts. And there's no rhyme or reason to it. So the prices are so unbelievably inflated that they end up being like $150, $200 for this. As it would stand, my friend Ed was at the ham radio convention in Colorado a couple of weeks ago. And he called me up and he says, I found one. It's cosmetically sound. It looks really nice. It's got the probe on it. The probe needs a little bit of work. But other than that, you know, the guy's asking for $30, and then I said, Ed, you know, pick it up for me, and then he turns around to the guy, and then he haggles with him over some cosmetics. He gets it for me for $20. So thank you, Ed, you know. So here we go. In probably what ends the different things that I need as far as test equipment is this Heathkit. And as we take a look at it, and I'll tell you, you know, in what was in its day the poor man's oscilloscope, you know, if you couldn't afford an oscilloscope, you had one of these. What you couldn't see, you listened to, and it had a magic eye, and I'll tell you that there's some electrical tape on here, and these plastic knobs are missing for the banana jacks, and they could easily be replaced. Those are easy to come by. You know, and it has the same knobs that I use for my other equipment. It's of the same genre. Obviously, there's a little work that needs to be done. You know, this magic eye is off, but this is in very nice condition, emblazoned with the Heathkit logo. You know, very much like this scope, same knobs as this scope, and these were a workhorse in their day. You know, so they got banged around and kicked around, and they're in a shop. When you see them, a lot of them are trashed, you know. They really got rode hard and put away wet. So when you see them, when they do appear, they're really in crappy condition. They're not looking good. And the ones that do look good that appear, they're so unbelievably inflated in price that you can never touch them. You know, nobody walked around, you know, going around servicing stuff with capacitor testers, you know, carrying them and smacking them into walls. But this thing was carried everywhere. So they're hard to find ones that are in good condition anymore. Let's take a look. I'll say the probe looks worse for wear, but is it? Right, because the cable's in good condition, and the probe appears in good condition, and it's got, you know, there's the ground clip. You know, back then, the ground went straight to the shell, and this shell is made of metal. So, you know, whatever you're holding on to, you know, beware. The needle at the end of this is missing, and I imagine that needle could be replaced, or I could buy like a crappy destroyed probe for like $2 on eBay. Or find one at a ham radio show and just, you know, replace the needle portion of this, put on a new label, you know, polish up that aluminum, and, you know, that'll be all, you know, running like new again. Just, you know, fix what's inside there. So that's all there is to that. Our look inside the box shows no burning, no water damage, you know, nothing in here that would have any cause for alarm. And I didn't think so looking at the outside of this unit, but I always check, you know. What we end up on the inside is really like a small, really small guitar amplifier, really small, like high gain amplifier with a magic eye tube is what we got here, you know. And I realize that's a really drastically oversimplification. People, oh, no, it's not what it is. Yeah, well, it's my movie. But this is what we got. We got like a little high gain amplifier, and basically you touch the probe to a circuit and get the speaker on and off switch, and I'm not sure what that says, but it says noise something. I guess I'll see that when I clean it. And then you set the volume, and not only will you hear whatever you hear, but the intensity of the signal will be displayed in the Magic Eye Tube. This black speaker connector was bent down. I was able to get some steel rod in there after removing the plastic on this banana connector and then bending it back up, so that was easy to fix. And not only did it straighten it out, but it pulled that bow out of the metal there, so that was pretty good. These will obviously be polished up. You can see it looks white with the light on because there's so much oxidation on that metal, but it's actually aluminum. Unfortunately, when this black stuff came off, it took off the paint with it. So, you know, I'm going to have to take some matching enamel paint and put it back down on here and then polish it out, you know, to clean this up. So I'm going to have to remove this black. This is going to be a separate project to do this. So I've removed as much as I'm going to do right now. And then when the rest is done, this will be focused on as sort of like a bodywork repair. The one tube we see removed is original Heathkit, or, you know, labeled Heathkit. For this unit is a 12CA5. So this will be cleaned, and then we'll test that. That'll be one of the tubes that is part of this unit. I'll pull out the next one. Next tube we pull out is a 12AX7, you know, preamplifier tube. It's a sort of a dual circuitry in this tube that we generally find in, like, you know, like a guitar amplifier or a radio. So, you know, it stands to reason we'd find it in this as well. So, very common tube, still made today, you know, 12AX7. So that's the other tube that's in this unit. We'll test that one too. And then we'll pull out the third tube. When pulling out these tubes, generally not a good idea to try and pull them out of these phenolic boards after they're removed from the springs. It's generally a good idea to get a screwdriver under here and then go around wedging it. So I'm going to stick the screwdriver in, wedge it, and then go around to the next one and wedge it until there's enough tube removed, or else you're just going to break the tube or the board. It can't just be pulled out like these from the other sockets. It has to be done carefully. This tube says VT138 and also says very faintly 1629. I'm not entirely sold on the fact that this is the correct tube for this unit. I'm willing to bet that it may be wrong. I may be wrong, but I'm going to check that because I don't think that's the right tube. Not a big deal, but I'm just getting that feeling. I'm going to have to get a copy of the book. But those are the three tubes in this unit. Those are the only three. In removing them, we see, obviously, remaining is the power transformer, you know, supporting circuitry, the switches, connectors. Yeah, I mean, it's in good condition. Resistors need to be tested here, as you could see. Some capacitors here that are down here. There's not a lot of components, you know. They're just some resistors, some capacitors. I think there's one down here. There's like one paper capacitor. You can see all the way down the bottom there. Just one, you know. This is a triple electrolytic, right? So this is the only component besides that one paper capacitor down there that would be any concern. And this electrolytic is a 50-50-20 microfarad, I believe, right? So that'd be interesting to put that on the IT-11 and see what's going on with that. You know, a couple potentiometers, and then this old Model 50 diode that I've seen in my Heathkit equipment. This is very, look at the size of that diode. I mean, back then, boy, you know, that is one hell of a diode. But in all my other equipment, this diode is still working. So I check them, and if the diode is still working, I leave it in, you know, because I haven't had one fail yet. So the other thing I want to look at to be sure, you know, obviously, is if this was a different tube, you know, if somebody just stuck it in there to sell it, or if somebody's been using it to make sure that If they were using a different tube, if this has changed, and if any supporting resistors or what have you has been modified on here to accommodate a different tube, I need to know that as well. So I'll have to go through that. So what are we left with at the end of the day? We have a speaker, but we have lugs for an external speaker, right? An on-off switch, level, which is volume, right? And I guess it's not just volume, because not only, I imagine level doesn't only affect the sound coming out of the speaker, but the Magic Eye tube as well, right? Connections for an output transformer, right? So instead of connecting output to a speaker, I guess you could, you know, match a transformer to here. There's the B plus and the other connections that you would need to accomplish that. And then there's the ability to turn the speaker on and off, and it's as if this says noise, and I'm not quite sure. Gonna get the book, you know, soon, download it, but there's another switch here that accomplishes something. And on the on this here, I think there was something that, yeah, you know, I really can't tell. I'm gonna have to, again, get the manual. But, you know, really brief tour. There's not a whole hell of a lot going on with this thing. That's all the controls that there is. It's not until you start cleaning vacuum tubes and CRTs that you start to truly realize how many layers of tobacco, tar, nicotine, and God knows what from cigarettes were on the glass as you slowly peel away at it. And, you know, obviously it comes off really easy from glass, but when you remove the layers of tar, when you wipe away and you see the different layers come off, that's when you really see the different layers of black that get removed from these things. And people who work with tubes, they know that you have to be very careful around the, you know, the white powder. So I was careful to do that and keep the names on there. But yeah, here's the tubes. They're all cleaned up and ready for testing. I can now definitely confirm, after removing all these layers, that this is a model 1629. You can see that silhouette that's etched into the tube, 1629. So now I'll take a look at that. I was able to confirm with the book that all three model tubes are correct, including this one. So that's good news. We will be able to now take these tubes and test them on the tube tester. Our first contestant is the 12AX7, which is nothing to write home about, but for our purposes will be just fine. For this preamplification, reads 85, well into good. We'll move on to the next tube. I shut off the backlight for this one. Them beam power tubes, they don't light up like a Christmas tree. The filament in the middle is very large and flat. You can see they really have a nice glow to them. It seems more interesting to look at the tube light up than it is to actually check the readings on this. If that is such, it actually dropped my line adjustment slightly. I'm going to turn that up. That sits up here in 36. This is still a 12 volts, you know. So adjusting our voltage for 35 as specified. 12CA535 on 38. Let's take a look. And yeah, that's off the chart. So, I mean, you know, there's nothing wrong with this beam power tube. We're going to call that good, and we're going to move on to our next one, which is the Magic Eye tube. I don't get to plug a lot of Magic Eye tubes into this test set, so I figured I might as well do it live just to see what happens. So I've already set it up, and it's going into socket 11, so we'll just spin and flip and find the key. There it is, and we'll see what we get. You can see the heaters are working. They appear to be. Yep, the heater is working. It's a little slow to start. You can see a glow emanating from there. I don't know if we're necessarily going to see any green. I don't know if there's any special instruction to measure Magic Eye. So I'll have to take a look. Well, I imagine I'd have to hit the quality button, obviously, but that goes without saying. Let it cook for just a second here. It should be pretty cool if it works. You ready? Let's hit it. Wasn't as impressive as I hoped. It And it shows the quality to be good as far as the test set goes. Reset the line adjust. I don't know if that necessarily means that we're going to see an output on the tube itself visually. But it does show a 90, so if I was looking at this as a regular testing of a tube, I would say, yeah, the tube is good because it showed all the way to 90. So I'll say this tube is definitely not testing bad. I did finally get my hands on the instruction manual as well as a schematic. I wanted to point out some things. And this also applies to some of the other units that I have that contains this. I've listed this device as a diode, you know, which it is, you know, so to speak. And this is this Model 50 that I've pointed out on other units as well. Interesting note, though, that in this book, it mentions that this is actually selenium. It's a selenium rectifier, apparently, you know, and I thought that was kind of interesting because in some other manuals, it just, you know, says diode. I never really gave it a second thought. And I said, right, or I never really considered it. I said, wow, you know, that's a really big diode, you know, but I guess, you know, for the amount of current and the size of it, obviously, you know, it is a selenium rectifier in a box and that's it. So I'm probably going to review the other manuals for the other pieces of equipment that I have, but I'd like to see it on the IT1121 and see what the readings are as presented on the oscilloscope for something like that, since now I know it's selenium and not silicon. But I just wanted to point that out. Other things discovered is this. The switch is switches between audio, which we could faintly see the words audio on there, and the other one is RF, depending on what application is being used. So that was another thing discovered. I gotta say that this is probably the simplest schematic of any Heathkit I've ever worked on, as you can plainly see, considering that this whole portion is just the probe. You know, this is the heater, you know, rectifier, power supply. There's not much going on here. One thing that I really do have to do on this unit is and it's hardly an issue, is make sure all of these resistors are in specification. And that's just going to be a shotgun test of just going through all these resistors and capacitors, because there's so few components. It would just be foolish not to. What I would like to do, because there's so little work or so few components that's on this would be one of those rare candidates for me to hook this up to the IT11 and see if I could reform this capacitor, see what condition it's in, you know, kind of hook it up and see if we could actually reform this over time using the capacitor checker right over here. So we'll do a couple things here. We'll see if we could get this thing going. Another feature not discussed was the noise button right here, and this is the switch over here. And apparently, as I'm made to understand, a noise injects 100 volts into the end of this, and basically the circuit is created, and I haven't read this thoroughly, but the circuit is created 100 volts from the end of the probe to ground through an individual component, and what that does, it allows you to hear through a component. So if you have a noisy resistor or capacitor or something, you're able to identify that by putting voltage through that component and listening to that component through a voltage that's supplied from the probe itself and not voltage that's supplied from the device under test. So noise is a feature. However, noise is also supplying 100 volts through the probe. So you can see that if you turn noise on and you're not careful, you're in for a shock, you know what I'm saying? So, food for thought. It should come as no surprise, obviously, by looking on the schematic, that there is some circuitry within the probe, a diode and a capacitor, and a switch that obviously changes the flow of the circuitry. And the shell, which I've removed to expose this in the ground. So this is going to need to be cleaned up, obviously, and checked to make sure that these components are working well as well, you know, and put back together as soon as a suitable replacement part for this can be found. This is just a tip missing. That's all that is, and a screw and a label. Also, a little bit of chrome paste polish the aluminum right up. Doesn't really take much. I used, what I use here, some SimChrome that I use on the motorcycle. So, you know, like 40 years of crap is just pulled out of the aluminum in just 1 minute. The kit even allows for two screws that can be loosened to remove this area to allow for more work to be done under here once that magic eye tube is removed. And this will allow me to test the resistors under here that would not be easily accessible without doing so. So that makes that a whole lot easier to test the resistors and circuitry under the 12AX7. This will actually prove to be really convenient when it comes time to reform this capacitor, not having this metal piece covering the capacitor like it was. Well, it wasn't that terrible, but it was covering a good portion of this capacitor, and now this whole area is wide open, so that's really nice. I've gone through all the resistors in the unit, and they've climbed a little bit, but nothing outside of specification. So at this time, I do not plan on replacing any of these resistors. This is going to be the only type of component that I'm going to test at this time without breaking out any of the other specialized equipment for like diodes and capacitors and what have you, you know, the rebuilding of capacitors. For the diodes, I would be interested to see what their trace looks like. So I'm going to be doing that for the selenium rectifier as well as the simple diodes, which also exist, or simple diode for that matter. Look like there was only one in here that also exists in this unit, to see what that looks like as well. So that should be pretty interesting. But so far, you know, things are looking good for this unit, aside from, you know, some things that we usually expect for something this age, as well as some unfortunate cosmetic repairs that are going to have to be made. You know, it looks like somebody just left a piece of electrical tape on there, is all that it was. And this is all gonna have to be, you know, sanded down carefully in and around the lettering, and then I'm gonna have to get some paint and carefully paint it on and smooth it back down. And for the lettering areas, it's just gonna have to be like really small brush and actually just tap the letters back on over it on white. So, you know, you gotta do what you gotta do.